All right. Well, having grown up in the 50s, the transistor radio was more powerful and more important than the internet. I'll say that again, but I won't. Once you had a transistor radio, it meant that you could take the soundtrack of your life to the stoop, the roof, the beach, the park, and you had your own private soundtrack. Transistor radios only had one earphone. You could snake it around your pillow and work the dial like a safecracker at night, trying to zoom in on a station in the Midwest or wherever you would be coming in late at night and hear other music. And your parents would think, of course, you were asleep. It told people where to get together and meet. It was the internet in the sense that people were all going to get together at the airport, or there was a concert or a poetry reading. But this was the only way to get that information, and there was nothing more important than a transistor radio. Everything in my apartment, without question, has a story. I don't own things just for the heck of owning it. Let's see. There you have the earliest known Bob Dylan postcard. It's for the concert on November 4th, 1961 at the, that Izzy Young from the Folklore Center had promoted. And that's a postcard that went out for people to purchase if they wanted to buy tickets.
Is that the Carnegie Hall?
This is the Carnegie Chapter Hall. There were 57 tickets sold, but if you speak to people, there are 700-800 people who were there. We were waiting online at the Fillmore East to see, and I believe it was a Byrds Procol Harum concert, and a gentleman was working the line selling a white jacketed vinyl album. Turned out it was a double album. And I'd never seen a what now is known as a bootleg record before, and then went back to a East Village crash pad and listened to The Great White Wonder for the first time. Now we know that it had a lot of the earliest known recordings of Bob Dylan from Minnesota, which people hadn't heard. And it also contained whatever it was that Bob was doing up there in the mountains with the band up there in Woodstock. We now call them the basement tapes, but this was the first time we heard any inkling of what any of that sounded like. And it could change your life. I had my life changed almost on a weekly basis with vinyl. The Bob Dylan button collection. That would be this over here. And this is like, you know, 50 years of Bob Dylan concert buttons, etc. All Bob Dylan known stamps. So, Ray Davies, Rick Danko, Bob Dylan, Thule Kofferberg, Donovan, Lou Reed, and it just goes on and on. And so all of these people have taken the time to sign a baseball for me. First of all, the first thing I should point out is all these suitcases that make this apartment look like Ellis Island are all filled with either VHS or some other dead format that's migrating its way to a digital format in a much more organized fashion once they get melted out of these things, which has to happen in real time, unfortunately. And when things get too big for a shelf, alphabetically around the apartment here, they end up in their own box, and then they get moved off site. We lived next door to somebody who had inherited the piano from the Big Pink House, from the basement tape house. And while I had the piano for a number of years, an upright piano that was Richard Manuel's piano, I could no longer keep the entire piano, which never played well, but I did keep a lot of the front wooden pieces. This is the famous piano where people come from like everywhere in the world and go, oh, could I maybe please have a screw from the piano? For me, Bob Dylan was the logical thing. I was a New Yorker, he was accessible. He's part of the mythology of almost everywhere I've lived. And New York is a kind of environment that if it existed anytime and anywhere in the world, it probably can be found in New York. You have people here who share in that experience, who maybe Bob Dylan spent a lot of time recording in their living rooms or in their basements. And these people are the people who I've spent time cultivating and exploring what it is that they're nurturing, you know, what do they covet And it's taken 40 or 50 years to get a lot of these people to actually share the music that deal with the American New York folk movement. In talking about the evolution of the singer-songwriter in Greenwich Village, it's hard to imagine without Bob Dylan.